Good morning, children. We are once again back in the same chapter, that is surface chemistry. And if you remember, in the last class we have discussed about the classification of colloids. In today's part we are going to discuss methods of preparation of colloid. And we know that soap is also a colloidal solution. So in this soap, actually soap is actually a sodium or potassium salt of long chain fatty acid. So when you see a piece of soap, we might be using different types of soaps for different purposes, right? And these different types of soap, it may be a washing soap, it might be a bathing soap, it might be a cleaning soap. In all these types of soaps, actually soap is a long chain fatty acid. Soap is a sodium or potassium salt of long chain fatty acid. Soap is a sodium or potassium salt of long chain fatty acid. Now, what is this long chain fatty acid? See, these fatty acids are actually stearates. See, these fatty acids are actually stearates. And in case of stearates, what we see that it is actually a salt of a stearic acid. So you can see soap. Soaps are the sodium or potassium salts of long chain or higher fatty acid. One example of stearic acid they have given you, CH3CH2 whole 16 COONA. So it is a sodium salt of this long chain fatty acid, that is called as soap. After that, we are going to discuss the methods of preparation of colloid. So here we have various methods. The first method is called chemical method. Now, what is the chemical method? So colloids can be prepared by the chemical reactions leading to the formation of molecules, and these molecules aggregate leading to the formation of salts. See, they aggregate to leading to the formation of this type of salts. So these are some of the methods by which these colloids can be prepared. Okay, so one method is a chemical method. One example of a chemical method is that we have arsenic oxide, AS2O3, that is made to react with H2S, and on double decomposition that forms arsenic sulfide and water. Okay, these are the methods of preparation by the process of double decomposition. Next we have is the electrical disintegration, or Bredig's arc method. This is another method. That is the electrical disintegration method or the Bredig's arc method. In this Bredig's arc method, what we actually do, the process involves the dispersion as well as the condensation. See, the process involves dispersion as well as the condensation. That in this method, electric arc is set in between the electrodes of the metal immersed in the dispersion medium. The intensity produced vaporizes the metal, which then condenses to form the particles of colloid. Okay, these are the methods by which it has been produced, and the method is called a Bredig's arc method. And this process is called Bredig's arc method. That is sulfur dioxide and H2S on oxidation. When sulfur dioxide gas is passed through H2S, that actually gives us sulfur salt and that of water. This is the method by which it has been produced. Okay, now another method is the peptization method. Now, what is this peptization method? In the peptization method, what we see, it is the process of converting a precipitate into the colloidal solid. And in this method, what actually happens, as you could see, that it is a process of converting a precipitate into the colloidal salt by shaving with the dispersion medium in the presence of a small quantity of an electrolyte. And this process is used for the purpose and is called by the help of an agent, and this agent is called as the peptidizing agent. See, in the presence of a peptidizing agent, we just perform it. So if I want to repeat the process of peptidization, in this process actually what happens in this process actually what happens in this process actually what happens the peptidization may be defined as the peptidization may be defined as the process in which it is a process of converting a precipitate into colloidal salt by shaking it with a dispersion medium. See, you people know what is precipitate? That is the solid that collects at the bottom of the test tube after a double decomposition, a double displacement reaction. Now the precipitate can be changed into a colloidal form, and the colloidal form can be that you can just simply react that, you can just simply react that in presence of a suitable solvent that will convert it into a precipitate, and this process is called as peptidization. This process is called as peptidization, and this takes place in the presence of a small amount of electrolyte which is used for this purpose is called as a peptidizing agent. So just remember, this type of colloidal solution which is used is called as a peptidizing agent. This type of a colloidal solution that is used is called as a peptidizing agent. Okay, this is how the reaction takes place. After the next topic we are going to discuss is the purification of colloids. How can we purify a colloid? See, the process used for the purification of colloid, we have a number of methods. The first method is dialysis, second method is electrodialysis, and the third method is ultrafiltration. See, the third method is called as ultrafiltration. Now, what is this dialysis method? It is a process of removing a dissolved substance from a colloidal solution by means of diffusion through a suitable membrane. So it is a process of removing a dissolved substance from a colloidal solution by means of diffusion through a suitable membrane. Okay, these are the methods by which we can simply separate. You might have heard that people who suffer from various types of kidney disorder, they actually perform this, or they actually do the process of dialysis. Okay, so the first method is dialysis. In this method, what we do, it is a process of removing a dissolved substance from a colloidal solution by means of diffusion through a suitable membrane. We actually perform this specific process, okay, and this process is called as dialysis. After that, see, we have the next process, that is electrodialysis. If the same process of dialysis is performed by help of an electric current, if the process of dialysis is quite slow, it can be made faster by applying an electric field. If the dissolved substance is impure electricity, then it is called as electrodialysis. So if the process is performed by the help of an electric current, then it is called as electrodialysis. So in the electrodialysis method, what we actually do in this process, the dialysis process takes place, but here we apply electric current, okay, that is called as electrodialysis, and here actually we take the help of an electrolyte. Next is ultrafiltration. What is ultrafiltration? It is the process of separating the colloidal particles from solution and the soluble solutes present in the colloidal solution by a specifically prepared filter are permeable to all substance except our colloidal particle. That is the method of ultrafiltration. So what is ultrafiltration? It is the process of separating the colloidal particles from that of the solution and the soluble solute present in the colloidal solution by a specifically prepared filter. And the specifically prepared filter is called as ultrafiltration. Now, next process we have is ultracentrifugation. What is this ultracentrifugation method? In this process, the colloidal solution is taken in a tube which is placed in an ultracentrifuge. On rotating the tube at very high speed, the colloidal particles settle down at the bottom of the tube and the impurities remain in solution. The particles are mixed with dispersion medium to regenerate the salt. Particles are present in the dispersion medium simply to regenerate the salt. So that is the method of ultracentrifugation. Okay? That is the method of separating it. After that, we are going to discuss the properties of colloids. Here, see, so there are three methods by which we can separate. The first method is dialysis, second is electrodialysis, third is ultrafiltration, and another method we have is ultracentrifugation. Now we will discuss the properties of colloids. Under the properties of colloids, positively charged colloid particles, they include metallic oxide. See, we have a number of metallic oxide like ferric oxide, chromium oxide, aluminium oxide. They are called as positively charged colloidal particles. Okay. And the basic dye stuff like malachite green, methylene blue, these are all examples of basic dye stuff. Examples: hemoglobin, that is the blood. Negatively charged colloidal particles are the sulfides like arsenic sulfide, antimony sulfide salts. Acidic dye stuffs like eosine, methyl orange, Congo red, these are all examples of those colloids which are actually positively charged. See, acid dye stuff, these are also examples of this colloid. Example, just see, starch, salt, gum, gelatin, clay, charcoal, egg albumin, all these are examples of those types of salts. After that, we are going to discuss the color of this colloid. Now, what is the color of this colloid? See, one thing, the color actually depends on another property, and that property is that the color of colloids. The color of the colloidal solution depends upon the wavelength of light by the colloidal particles, which in turn depends upon the nature and size of the particles. Okay. By this nature, that is the color. The color of also depends upon the manner in which light is received by this observed one. Okay, the color depends on the light which is being observed. Okay, that is the color of the solution. After that, see, one important thing you should know, that is the Brownian movement. Now, what is the Brownian movement? Brownian movement actually means it is the haphazard zigzag motion of the colloidal particles are known as the Brownian movement. The haphazard zigzag motion is called the Brownian motion, and this haphazard motion is because of the size of the particles of the colloid, and it has been observed that it can be easily seen by help of a powerful ultra microscope. Okay, it is due to the unbalanced bombardment. Of the colliding movement of the dispersion medium with that of the dispersed phase constantly with the colloidal particles. Next important property is the colligative property. See, while we were discussing the chapter on solution, what we know that colligative properties of the colloid of the solution depends on the number of the particles present, that is the values of colloidal properties for a colloidal solution are smaller in comparison to that of a truth solution. So in case of colloidal particles, this movement is much larger. But in case of a non-colloidal solution, this movement is comparatively much less. So you should understand that the values of colligative properties for colloidal solution are smaller in comparison to that of a type of a true solution. Why? Because you see, this is because of the colloidal particles are bigger aggregates. Because the size of colloidal particles are much larger, they form aggregates, they form huge masses. So their values are comparatively much, I should say, lesser. So colligative properties are much more. Next we have the Tyndall effect. What is the Tyndall effect? Tyndall effect is the scattering of the light, that is the scattering of a beam of light by that of the colloidal particle. See, the scattering of the beam of light by that of a colloidal particle is called the Tyndall effect. So the scattering of beam of light by the colloidal particles is called Tyndall effect. This bright cone of light is called the Tyndall cone. So Tyndall effect is another characteristic feature. Tyndall effect is another characteristic feature of that of a colloidal particle. Okay. Sorry, children. After that, next important property we have is the charge on the colloidal particle. See, colloidal particles develop certain amount of charge. Colloidal particles develop actually certain amount of charge. Now, the certain amount of charge that these colloidal particles develop always depends on the electric nature of these substances. Okay, that actually depends on the nature of these substances. So, just remember that the colloidal particles always carries an electric charge, and nature of the particle is dependent on After that, we have the Helmholtz electrical double layer. Now, when the colloidal particles acquire negative or a positive charge by the selective adsorption of one of the ions, it attracts the counter ions and the medium, forming a second layer. The combination of these two layers of opposite charges around the colloidal particle is called as the Helmholtz electrical double layer. It is called as the Helmholtz electrical double layer. After that, you see, we have the next important property that is called the electrokinetic potential, or that is called as zeta potential. Electrokinetic potential, or that is called as the zeta potential. Now, in that zeta potential, what we have observed, see, electrokinetic potential or zeta potential, the potential difference between the layer and the diffuse layer opposite charges is called the electrokinetic potential. Okay, that is called the electrokinetic potential. After that, we have electrophoresis. What is electrophoresis? The movement of the colloidal particles under the applied electric potential is called electrophoresis. That is, the movement of the colloidal particles under the applied electric field or electric potential is called as electrophoresis. Okay. Then we have coagulation or precipitation. What is coagulation or precipitation? The process of settling of colloidal particles as a precipitate is called as coagulation. So coagulation is a process in which we see that when we put an electrolyte or an ionic substance, it actually coagulates, and these properties called coagulation. After that, we have the Hardy-Schussel's rule. According to Hardy-Schussel's rule, what we just see, that oppositely charged ions are affected for coagulation. The coagulating power of the electrolyte increases with the increase in charge. After that, we have types of emulsion. What are the different types of emulsion? Water dispersed in oil and oil dispersed in water. What is water dispersed in oil? When water is the dispersed phase and oil is the dispersion medium, example is butter. And oil dispersed in water is that when oil is the dispersed phase and water dispersion medium, for example, milk. Then we have emulsification. What is emulsification? emulsification. It is the process of stabilizing the emulsion by means of a chemical substance. Then emulsifying agent or emulsifier. These are the substances which are added. These are the substances which are added. These are the substances which are added in order that the emulsification can take place. They are called as emulsifying agent or emulsifier. Then the next one we have is de-emulsification. It is the process of breaking an emulsion into its constituent component, either by freezing, boiling, centrifugation, or some other chemical method. Okay, children, that was all for the day. Thank you.